Welcome, everybody, to this episode of Veganic Gardeners Question Time. I'm super excited to be the host for you today. My name is Luke Scott III, and I have been all about veganic gardening since I found out about it. I'm spreading the word. I'm telling as many people as possible, and I'm also on a project at the moment building a vegan eco-village for around 150 people. And we're going to have a big 40-acre farm so we can be pretty self-sufficient. And we're going to make that a fully veganic farm, which is why I've been working very closely with the Vegan Organic Network, and they're helping so much to do this. And actually, one of the first things I did was ask a question on the Veganic Gardeners Question Time, and the advice I got was so helpful. So if you do have any questions for us that you'd like us to cover on future shows, please do get in touch. And we have some amazing panelists today who are going to answer the questions that we've already had sent in and just give you straight from the heart their experience. And we have some wonderfully experienced people. We have Piers Warren, and Piers is a conservationist. He's an author, and he's also a keen grower of organic fruit and vegetables. He's also the founder of Wild Eye, which is the International School of Wildlife Filmmaking. And he's also written several books. He's the co-author of The Vegan Cook and Gardener. So Piers, welcome. Thank you so much for coming on this episode of Veganic Gardeners Question Time. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Thanks. Thanks for the intro and having me on the show.
I know you're a regular on the show, Piers, and you always bring so much wisdom, and it's really wonderful. Why do you think we need to tell the world more about veganic gardening? Why do you do this?
Well, I just passionately believe that it's the way to go in terms of food production for the health of the planet and, of course, the animals and of ourselves.
I agree 100%. I think it's the most sustainable, the most kind, and makes the most delicious, healthy food as well. It's a win for everybody, right? Thank you. And we also have on the show today Meghan Kelly. And Meghan learned veganic permaculture so she could become more self-sufficient whilst also sticking to her vegan values. And she's been practicing veganics now for over 10 years in different community gardens, also in concrete jungles. And she runs the Learn Veganic online course, which you all want to check out. It's a 7-week online gardening course. And Meghan also co-founded the Veganic Agriculture Network. So lots of great stuff happening. Meghan, thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks so much for having us, Luke.
Tell us a little bit about the Veganic Learn Veganic online course. That looks absolutely amazing.
Yeah, so we just did our first 7-week Learn Veganic course this spring. We had lots of wonderful people join us from around the world for the course, and a few nonprofit organizations joined us too to learn about veganic gardening. So it's a 7-week course that's kind of a crash course for people to introduce them to a lot of different veganic gardening techniques, because there's so many techniques that have been developed over the decades that weren't always developed as veganic techniques, but are really useful to veganic gardeners. So we really give people an overview of different techniques. So we just finished up our first course. We'll be offering another one in a few months. But in the meantime, we have a self-study course that people can do kind of as a self-paced online course if they're interested.
Fantastic. When I first learned about veganic growing, I thought it might be complicated, and I went on the Vegan Organic Network's YouTube channel. Everybody should check that out and subscribe. And there's these amazing documentaries called Growing Green. And I realized it's actually quite simple. And begs the question, why doesn't everybody do it? Do you see a world in the future, Meghan, where more farmers adopt veganic growing and we can get everybody having this nice healthy food that's good for
them? Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think right now when we look at organic, you know, I mean, while there's a certification for it, you know, some of the materials that are used behind that don't necessarily correspond with what you'd really think of as being genuinely organic. For example, in North America, you know, factory farm waste from, you know, chicken farms can be used in organic agriculture. And that means that we've got, you know, rice with arsenic in it and things like that, that in no way correspond with what people want to purchase when they're purchasing organic food. So I think if there's more awareness around issues like that, and right now I think, you know, there's so much manure on the market because, you know, meat production is so prevalent, but as that diminishes and there's not so much sort of free or cheap, you know, animal waste available, I think more and more people will be turning to veganics for that reason too.
Absolutely. I was horrified as a vegan, if you can tell from my t-shirt, when I realized that most of the organic foods I've been buying had been grown in fish and blood and bone and manure, and it just never even factored in. I thought it says organic, it must be aligned with my values, but it really wasn't. So thank you so much for everything that you're doing. That's really brilliant. And we're going to talk more later. We've got lots of questions for you.
Wonderful.
And we also have on the show today Stephane Groleau. And Stephane loves innovating and finding new ways to veganize anything and everything. And he studied organic vegetable farming and visited veganic farms all across Europe. And he also co-founded the Veganic Agriculture Network in 2008 and also teaches the online gardening with the Learn Veganic course. Stephane, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me.
Absolutely. Tell us more about the Veganic Agriculture Network. It's been going since 2008. That sounds amazing.
Yeah, but in fact, because I studied organic farming in the beginning of 2000, and I wanted to learn more about veganic farming and stock-free farming. So I went in Europe for months to visit different farms. And when I went back to North America, because I'm based in Quebec, I wanted to bring these ideas here in Quebec. I wanted to network with people. I wanted to share the information. And there is the English part and the French part, and especially in French, because I'm French speaking, as you can listen here with my accent. So I wanted to have this information in French. So that's why I met Meghan, and together we were working, Meghan more Anglophone and Francophone. So we decided to start this network based here in North America so that we can bring these ideas of growing without any animal input here in North America. And that's how we started the network, the website, doing talks and doing booths in different events. So that's how we started to get involved in the movement here around here.
Fantastic. And if anybody wants to get involved with the Veganic Agriculture Network, how do they get in touch with you?
But they can contact us on the website at goveganic.net. And there is also, in French, I started a Facebook group, which is Agriculture Végétalienne au Québec. So to try to network with French people also. So if people want, but the website would be a good resource if people want to get in touch, and or they can also join the Learn Veganic, because it's also part of what we want to do, to give more classes and to teach people how to do.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Really looking forward to this one. I'm sure it's going to be absolutely amazing. If you're interested in the Learn Veganic course, it's www.learnveganic.com, and you can go check it out. And there's a self-study part, like Meghan said, as well at the moment. So we're going to get into the questions very shortly. But before we do that, we have a little surprise that one of our listeners has sent in. And so we're going to play a little video now from Dan's
garden. Got a surprise here today in the garden, and it's not the spinach or the tulips or daffodils or even the euphoria or the bleeding heart. Over here we have it's fallen over. We have a lovely picture and a note from Maggie. Yeah, I think Maggie painted this picture, and her note says, "Thank you to all the staff for their hard work. I really enjoy Gardener's Question Time. It's so interesting. Please say thanks to all that make it possible, including the panel. Kind regards, Maggie." Well, thank you very much, Maggie. You've made our day. Hope you enjoy today's show.
Isn't that nice that somebody cares so much that they sent us in a picture? And that's why we're doing this, right? We're doing this to help people. I think it's so nice when you just someone sends a little note or gets in touch, and it brought a smile to us anyway. We thought it was really beautiful. So thank you, Maggie, and thank you for everything that you do and being such a wonderful person. So let's get started. We've got the first question from Rob. And Rob asks, what is the best way to keep fresh picked vegetables fresh? He says, I'm fairly new to this and have been disappointed at how quickly my ripe veggies go soft or turn colours after I have harvested them. How do those store-bought ones hold their freshness for so long? Thanks for the show. Does anybody feel inspired to answer Rob's question?
Yes, okay, well, one of the things to think about, first of all, is for a lot of produce, ideally, we will be practicing things like successional sowing so that we'll be harvesting very gradually rather than everything at once when, you know, a lot of the produce will need storing. The best way of planning what you're going to eat in the evening is just going out on the plot, seeing what's ready to harvest and picking exactly what you need for that evening's meal. But of course, in reality, it doesn't always work out like that. We have crops that we have to store. So I just want to quickly run through some of the methods that are used commercially for storing fruit and veg, some of which we can practice at home, some of which not so easy. And apple is a good example. So here is Exhibit A. This is an apple bought from a shop because I've now run out of my stored apples. And who knows how long ago this was picked. Sometimes the apples you see in supermarkets were actually harvested a whole year before they end up on the shelves. So how do they keep them in good condition for that long? Well, here are six of the things that they do. First of all is produce is often picked just before it's fully ripe. So it does the last bit of ripening on the shop shelf. As anybody who's bought an avocado will know, that's pretty hit and miss. The second thing is that harvested fruit and veg is stored usually at low temperatures and at a specific humidity. And over the years, producers have done a lot of experiments to see what's the best temperature and humidity for each type of produce that they're storing. And using things like fridges and containers, we can replicate some of that. I'll touch on that a bit later. Another thing is that they're often stored in low oxygen environments. This is because, you know, fruits like an apple, they're still, when they're first harvested, they're still living things. To a certain extent, they're still respiring. So if we take out the oxygen, replace it with carbon dioxide, that will slow that down. And as many of you know, the average percentage of oxygen in the atmosphere is around 21%. In storage, it could be anything from 0.5 to 3%. So really low amounts of oxygen there. Fourth thing is they may well be sprayed with fungicides to try and reduce the chance that any fungus will start rotting the fruit. And I don't know about you, but I really don't want to be eating something that's got fungicide on it. So that's not something I'd recommend. Some fruits and veg are covered with wax. Again, this is to keep the gases out that will enhance its decay. Cucumbers used to be regularly covered with wax, but that's now been replaced really with shrink wrap. And lemons, you might have heard, are very commonly wax. So if you're zesting a lemon, you really want to know whether it's been waxed or not, because you don't just want to put wax in your food. And then the other method, which is more modern, is there is a chemical called 1-methylcyclopropene. which is very similar to ethylene. And some of you may know ethylene is the gas that makes fruits ripen. If you have, for example, bananas that are getting yellow and maybe with brown spots as well, they're releasing lots of this ethylene gas. If you've got another fruit that you want to ripen quickly, you can put it with some of these ripe bananas and it will increase their ripening. So the ethylene gas gets into receptors within the fruit and speeds up this ripening. And they've discovered that instead of doing that by putting the fruit in an environment with one methyl cyclopropene, it gets into these receptors instead of the ethylene, and so it stops the fruit ripening. So these are six commercial methods, and obviously some of them we can't do. You know, we can't do the low oxygen at home, we can't do the fungicide, probably not the wax, and not the one methyl cyclopropene as well. But we can control things, as I said at the start, by using a fridge, for example. So it's a case of knowing what fruit and veg do well in a fridge and what do better outside the fridge, and also their humidity. So for example, if you pick a lettuce from your garden, just put it loose in your fridge, within a day or two, it will have wilted and gone really limp. But if you give it a slight spray of water, put it in a plastic bag or some kind of airtight container, then it will stay much fresher for several more days. Conversely, if you take something like roots, like carrots or parsnips, which if you bought them from a supermarket, sadly would probably come in a plastic bag. If you stick that plastic bag in your fridge, then the humidity will be too much for those root crops and they will start to rot fairly soon. If you take them out of the bag and put them loose in your fridge, then that won't be a problem. So it's a matter of finding out for each type of produce what conditions they like. Same way with storing things outside. For example, potatoes. If we store potatoes in Hessian sacks or something like that, they like a really dry environment. Whereas storing lots of apples, they prefer a moister environment. So if you've got a dry shed, that's where the potatoes go. If you've got a slightly damp outhouse, that's where the apples go. So those are just a few of the things that you can try at home. Hope that helps.
Thank you, Piers. Yeah, very, very good. Stefan, Meghan, do you have anything you'd like to share on how we can keep the fruits and veggies fresh for longer?
Well, one thing I could just add is that, I mean, with a lot of commercial produce, they've really selected varieties that stay fresh the longest possible, but sometimes it's in cases where the veggies and fruits don't have as much flavor, they don't have as many nutrients. So in some cases, you know, if you harvest something like a strawberry and it starts going off within a day, that's not necessarily a bad sign. It might mean you actually have a much higher quality strawberry than one that could have, you know, lasted through, you know, 1 or 2 weeks of, you know, transport and grocery store shelves. So I'd say in cases like that, if you have things that go off quickly, just, you know, enjoy them right off the plant or stick them right away in a freezer. That's what's done with a lot of foods that are, from farmers' fields. A lot of them will go straight from the field into the freezer. So if you have too much to eat at once, I'd suggest that. It's a really simple way of doing things if you have enough freezer space.
Fantastic. Yeah, Stefan?
Yeah, and I would just like to add that there are many fruits, but mostly veggies, that we can also just keep at room temperature. For example, cucumbers, tomatoes, or ground cherries, or if we have squash, or there's many things that we can just leave on the shelf and it will be fine for many days. And something I do, for example, here in Quebec, we have a frost in the winter. So if there are tomatoes that are still green on the plant just before the first frost, I would just cut the whole grape and leave it inside in a bowl with the cloth on it, and it will end up ripening by itself in a few weeks. So there are also strategies or to keep our veggies fresh inside, just at room temperature. So everything, we have to look at every vegetable have their own particularities.
Thank you all so much. I hope that helped, Rob, and good luck with your growing and your veggies, and I hope you can keep that up and keep them fresher for longer now. Brilliant. Let's move on to the next question. So this question comes from Richard. And Richard says, a colleague and I run a community allotment. We are trying to adopt a no-dig approach to improve soil health and enhance soil biodiversity. Our challenge is obtaining good compost in adequate quantities. We planted green manures and we make our own compost, which has been surprisingly successful. Soil improvers are anaerobically digested food. Waste are an option, but I understand that they are what they are called. They improve the texture of soil rather than being a good sowing medium. Do you have any suggestions? Does anyone feel inspired to answer this one for Richard?
Yeah, sure, I can take that one. So one thing about the digestate from that, you know, what's left over from the anaerobic digestion process is it should still have good nutrient content. I mean, if we look at the minerals like phosphorus and potassium, those are going to still be there. They might even be more concentrated in the digestate. So it's still going to serve a purpose as a fertilizer. In terms of having enough compost, one thing that's a really great addition to any community garden that you could even bring other people in the community to be involved in is community compost setups. In the city that we live in Quebec City, there's a nonprofit here that runs community composts where there might be dozens of people composting together. There's a huge waiting list in Quebec City. They have to add more and more sites each year. And a lot of the time it's people who are just really interested in the environmental aspect of composting because they don't want to throw all of their scraps in the garbage. And they might not even want the compost itself. So I think there are tons of opportunities for a small community garden to get the compost, all the veggie scraps from their neighbors in the neighborhood in order to have way more compost for your community garden. Also, you could consider getting veggie scraps from restaurants or from health food stores. I used to go pick up the veggies and fruits that were being thrown out from a health food store every Tuesday. I would show up every Tuesday afternoon when they got their new stuff coming in, and then they had everything else was going to go into a dumpster, any veggies and fruits that hadn't been sold that week. So I just collected everything and composted it. So that was great because it was all organic. You could also consider making leaf mold by collecting fallen leaves and composting those down. It makes a really, really good medium for improving your soil. Also wood chips, if you're able to get wood trimmings from tree surgeons that are cutting down branches around electrical lines and things like that, you might not want to put it directly on your garden because it can be really, really high carbon. If it was like bigger branches or tree trunks or anything like that, it would be a bit too high carbon to put directly on the garden. But if you put it in a pile and you let it decompose over, a year or two, eventually it'll break down into a soil-like consistency, and then you could use that for doing seedlings or for adding to your soil in your garden. Other things that you could do are just adding a lot of biomass directly in your garden, especially if you're doing no-till. You can add a lot of biomass directly to the surface of the soil. One thing we like adding is hay, because hay has a really good carbon nitrogen ratio. It's around 25:1 or 30:1. So it's kind of that carbon nitrogen ratio you'd want for making a compost pile, but you can just put it directly on your garden and it'll break down and it will just add to the soil over the years. And it will also boost the nutrients that you have. You can also add chipped branchwood. So chipped branchwood is branches from trees that are less than 7 centimeters in diameter, ideally even smaller than that, ideally branches that are smaller than a broomstick. They have reasonably good carbon nitrogen ratios. They might cause some nitrogen lockup if you put it in the spring, but if you put it in the fall, it shouldn't be too bad. But you can always grow some legumes there the next year if you have any concerns about nitrogen lockup. But that really is a wonderful material for building up the soil. It basically imitates what happened over millennia with tree branches falling in forests and creating some of the best agricultural soils. Many agricultural soils are really just from clear-cut forests. So we can imitate kind of that long-term, high-quality soil structure in our gardens by adding chip branch wood. But as I mentioned, you might get some nitrogen lockup. Your plants might not be that happy for the first season, so you could just add it. Just plant legumes like beans and peas for the first year. And then once it's broken down more, you could add a wider variety of plants. And also the other thing I'd mention is just growing a lot of biomass in your gardens. There are some plants like lettuce and carrots, when we harvest them, there's nothing really left to feed the gardens because we harvest almost everything when we harvest the plant. Where there's other plants like fava beans, for example, that when we plant them, they leave behind a ton of biomass that we could feed directly to the soil by leaving it on the surface, or we could put it in a compost bin. So you really have the option of, you know, growing just tons of biomass in the garden space itself, either in the garden plots or next to the garden plots that you could use to feed back to the soil to build it up.
Wow, that was a very detailed answer and like brilliant. I love how holistic that is as well, getting involved in your local communities, connecting with your restaurants and stores in your area, making sure we're not wasting things and just sending it to landfill. That's brilliant. I'm sure they were so happy to give you that stuff as well. I know there's a brilliant video on the Vegan Organic YouTube channel, Vegan Organic Network YouTube channel, from Growing with Grace, and they work with their local council to get a lot of their compost and stuff as well. So brilliant. Thank you, Meghan. Does anybody else have anything you want to add to that? Stephane?
I think Meghan gave a lot of information. So just little things that, for example, in Quebec City, I have access to a park where there is it's infested with stinging nettles. So there are resources locally that we can just use. So every year I just go and harvest a lot of stinging nettles, and I would do liquid feed with the stinging nettles. I could also use it as a biomass for the compost, or we could look around if there are any resources that we can use to get into the garden. And personally, I will even, if it would be a commercial, I wouldn't do this, but in my balcony garden, I would use urine, for example, to just bring some nitrogen. So, or we can also think about looking at plants like the lawn. If there is a lawn next to the garden, or we could just harvest the lawn and use it in a compost or as a mulch. So the idea is to look what are the resources. Meghan talked about food scrap or veggies that are getting off, but looking around the garden in the surroundings or with friends or people that don't do compost, or so just looking at for the resources around to have more compost and to have a living soil. Maybe we won't need that many that much compost also.
Excellent. Yeah, fantastic. So everyone, urinate on your plants in your balcony. That's great. I like that. Different tip. I love it. Thank you all so much. This is really good. We have another question now from Chris. And Chris says, I have my vegetable garden on a hillside, which I water every 3 to 4 days, giving all plants roughly the same. It is trellised, so I don't get a huge amount of runoff, but for some unknown reason, the plants at the top of the hill seem to perform poorly. Can you give me a reason for this? Stephane. You're muted, Stephane. If you could just switch your microphone on. Sorry. Thank you.
Okay. I was saying that I think it's a really interesting question, but it's true that I would have liked to have more information about how steep is the slope, or what's the exposure to the sun, or is there a lot of rain that goes on this slope, because and how much water the person is using when watering, because it's true that runoff or erosion on the ground might be very, very low, or because it's trellis, but there is always some leakage in the ground. So as soon as we water or it rains, some of the water will pick up the nutrients or dissolve some salt or nutrients and will just go down. So it's normal that on the top there will be some leakage that go down the profile, the salt profile, and the plants that are lower in the slope will have access to what's coming from up. So it's normal that there is less nutrients on the top and more at the bottom. So I think that's one thing to take into consideration. I don't know if there is a mulch or something that covers the ground, so to reduce the effect of the rain that comes. So some advice could be to water less often or with less water. And also, the more we have a soil that is alive and is fertile and diversified, the more we will keep the nutrients also in the ground. And one question would also be, what kind of soil it is? If it's sandy soil, it's much more prone to leakage as compared to clay soil, where it holds much more the nutrients. So there are considerations from this point of view of what kind of soil we have. So one thing could be also, if there's too much, I don't know the plants, if they are really, really good at the bottom, but if it's too fertilized, there might be also, it could also attract some insects, or it could be too much fertilization. So maybe it could put less compost or fertilization at the bottom and more at the top, because it will finish by going down. And having lots of perennials will also help to bring back the nutrients and to keep the nutrients and to keep the soil alive longer in the season or in the year. So the point is, I think the water will just dissolve the nutrients and bring the nutrients down the profile, and that's the main reason why there is a difference in the top and the bottom. So.
Great, thank you, Stephane. Does anybody have anything you'd like to add to that? Piers.
Just unmuting. So yeah, Stephane covered the important things there. The only thing I'd add is that it's quite likely that at the top of the hill, the plants are more exposed to maybe wind damage and things like that. So even if everything else was equal, I would probably expect the plants at the top, which are, you know, not as well protected, to not do as well. So, and again, there's not a huge amount you can do about that other than provide some protection for those at the top.
One thing I could mention too is at the top, for example, you might want to plant things like oregano and sage that can deal with tougher conditions. They can deal with having less water available at times and things like that. So just some tough perennial plants.
Excellent. Thank you all so much. And I think we have time for one more question. And this question comes from Stuttgart in Germany. I'm not sure how to pronounce your name. I'm going to say Heike. I apologize if I got that wrong. And it says, I'm an organizational developer / psychologist and kind of into gardening too. And I dream of starting my own business, connecting my passion for permaculture and interest in food sovereignty with my skills from facilitating, training, consulting. And I wonder if not being at least a trained gardener is a knockout criteria from the beginning. Do all of you who make a living out of permaculture have a gardening or agricultural background?
I can answer that. So I can say that, you know, I work as a gardening teacher right now, and my background is having a degree in English literature. At first, I felt a little bit strange about having studied English literature until I spoke to a farmer who was in exactly the same position, who had gone from that to farming. I think that when it comes to things like facilitating gardening experiences for people, having a background in psychology or social work, honestly, it's one of the best backgrounds you could have, because there's such a need for people to have experiences with gardening as a way to reconnect with nature and things like that. So oftentimes, even nonprofits or organizations that are facilitating gardening experiences, often they'd even look for somebody with a background in social work or psychology. So I think it's a perfect background to have. And I think that most people who work in permaculture probably started in other fields and eventually moved into it. So I think definitely we can take our different skill sets and different backgrounds and just meld them together. Definitely if you have a passion for permaculture and you take some courses and do especially a lot of hands-on learning, you can definitely take all your other skill sets and turn that into a meaningful job where you can help other people.
Fantastic. So you can go from English literature to having your own veganic online courses. So it's possible for anybody. Stephane, Piers, do you want to share a little bit about your background, and do you have a degree in gardening or agriculture? How did you get started?
My background, first, I grew up on a dairy farm. So that's how I was in contact with farming first. But I didn't really like to work with the animals on the farm. So I decided to put that aside and go study computerings. But it's by going into veganism and to have this reflection about how do we grow food, I decided to get more interested into organic farming. And it ended that I decided to go in even deeper in that and go study organic farming in a college. And that's how I was vegan when I studied organic farming. And so that's why I focused my research on my study on how to grow food without animal inputs. And that's how I went to Europe to have hands-on experience on different farms. So for the question, I would say the most important aspect is to, if we are really passionate about something and we get more experience in that, it will be really successful because we will just share our interest and people will just feel like, wow, I want to also learn and to get and dirty also. So yeah, that's my background.
And for me, my background was in science, and I did eventually do a 1 year full-time course in arboriculture, but by then I was already in my 30s. So a lot of my experience actually came from just doing it and knowing what went wrong and what went right and gradually building it up. And reading, of course, just reading books. There are so many books out there on gardening and growing and things like that. And here in the UK, I think people who work in horticulture or gardening come from all sorts of different backgrounds and have different levels of experience. I used to have a lodger who was a odd job gardener. He just looked after a few people's gardens, whether it was mowing lawns or trimming hedges or weeding or whatever it was. And although his level of knowledge to start with was very low, if he had something coming up, like a particular tree or shrub that he knew he would have to look after in somebody's garden, he would do his research. And in the evening, he'd often be looking through his textbooks, looking up the right way and the right time to prune a certain plant. And he grew his knowledge kind of organically as he went along. And as an odd job gardener, that served him fine. So like Meghan said, people come from all sorts of backgrounds, and that just all adds to the mix and the wisdom.
Absolutely. I would agree. I have a business background myself, and now I'm building a veganic farm. So it's been a really intense year of learning, and it's been an exciting year. I had no idea these things even existed just 2 years ago. And now I'm telling the world about it, shouting from the rooftops about the Vegan Organic Network everywhere I go. And it's very, very wonderful. So yeah, anybody can really do that. We have an amazing competition I'd love to share with everybody who's listening as well. It's called Save Our Wildlife. And we are inviting people to make a short video. So this should be a video, and there is first prize is £500, second prize is £300, and third prize is £200. And you can find out more about this at the Vegan Organic Network website, which is veganorganic.net. Because there are only 4% of the mammals on our planet are wildlife, 36% are human, and 60% are farmed animals. So this is the crazy state of play that we're in on our planet at the moment with these, you know, intensive animal farms. And we really, I have a daughter who's 9 months old, and it's a big concern to me that by the time she's my age, like, what percentage of mammals will actually be wildlife left on our planet unless we do something. So we're encouraging you to get creative, send us your short film, go to the veganorganic.net website for all the details. And yeah, we'd love to see what you can come up with, and hopefully you can win one of the prizes too and spread the message. I would love to do one more question before we go, if that's okay with everyone. So we have a question here from Emma. And Emma says, we are planning a forest garden, and currently the space is amenity grass with a few fruit trees, a couple of almond trees, and some fruit bushes. The edge is a mix of trees and laurel hedge on two sides and wall/fencing on the other side. We have a design planned and are interested in top tips for starting things and things to avoid. For example, how do we cut out all the grass? Who's feeling inspired to talk about forest gardens? What's your top tips, Stephane?
Yeah, it could be a whole course about how to create and start a forest garden. So I would say the first thing is for sure is to plan, because as soon as we talk about forest garden, we talk about perennials that would live for many years, and some might grow really tall and big. So the first idea is to plan and to know the land where we will be establishing the garden. So for example, to know where's the north, where's the south, because we will try to put, for example, the bigger trees on the north side and smaller on the side or before or in front. But that's planning with these big first and the smaller trees, bushes, and then other plants that will go underneath or around. So this is the first tips to look where to plant the plants on a plan before going into the garden. And we should plan also for at least 5 or maybe 10 years, depending on the trees, because if trees get really big, it might have an influence on the other plants that are surrounding these first trees or these trees. And that would be sad to have fruit trees too close to each other. And so that's so planning would be the first thing. And to plan correctly, we also should look at the climate zone, because when we want to establish a garden with different kind of fruits and trees and bushes, we want them to survive the winter. Especially here in Quebec, we have big frost during the winter, so we need to plant perennials that will survive the winter. So there are maps, and in Quebec we have climate zone maps, so we can see if I buy a tree or fruit tree, would it fits with the climate zone I am in. So that's part of the planning, and also to avoid planting something that will just die because of the winter. Or sometimes there are plants that are just limit for the zone, but in spring when they flower, the frost will just kill the buds or the flowers, so we won't have a good production. So also when planning, we should also aim to have different layers, big trees, small climbing plants, but also to diversify the family and to have plants that will fix nitrogen. We have cover crops, so we should think about all these different kinds of plants and aspects. So after the plan is the soil. Emma was talking about amenity grass. So how do we start? How do we plant in there? So the soil would be, is the other important aspects, depending what kind of soil. Is it clay soil? Is it sandy soil? For example, if it's clay soil, like I have in the countryside, it's better not to make a big hole and put the tree down there and fill the hole with the dirt, because it might just make a little pond with water all the time that will stay there, and that might just drown the tree. So we try to, if it's a clay soil, it's better to maybe loosen the soil underneath the tree, but have the create a little mound where we will put the plant there, the tree there, and cover with dirt, so to avoid to have the crown or the place where the stem and the root get attached together, to avoid that being too low in the ground. And anyway, all plants should be raised and not have the crown underneath the soil. And that's especially true if we buy trees that have been grafted. We should take care to avoid burying, to cover the graft with dirt, because this might bring the tree to root and the graft to root, and then we will lose the beneficial effects of the rootstock. And on the contrary, we should also look when we have these grafted trees to have the graft sufficiently high. And if we see shoots from the rootstock, we should remove these shoots, because if we leave the shoots to grow, it will just take all the energy, and the grafted tree will just probably might die, because the plant will just leave this part that has been grafted and just use the shoots instead. So we have to take pay attention to these kind of ideas. So to prepare the soil, what I really like is just to, if the grass is long, I will just maybe stamp on it and just put it down, and then cover with cardboard, or it could be also constrictor paper. And so just to lay the grass and cover with the cardboard, and then put mulch. Meghan was talking about chipped branchwood, which is a really good medium to just cover and create this kind of forest soil. So that's my technique that I prefer, because this avoid to just work the soil, and this is easy to cover a good area. But if we want, we could also just work the soil and then start planting there. But I really like to just cover and just leave the grass to decay underneath the mulch. And then for planting, there is all these ideas of creating guilds or mixing some plants, like a big plant for maybe an example, a big fruit tree like Asian pear, and with smaller trees like Siberian pea shrubs that will fix nitrogen, and we can have around gooseberries, and all this will be kind of a guild where they are quite close to each other. So this will cover part of the grass, and we will be more companion planting. So for the planting, I would say to have in mind that to have a diversity of plant, and to really look at the spacing that we will need for the plants when they are at maturity. That will be a good design option when we plant the plants. And also, for biodiversity settings in the forest garden, it's important to have, for example, a pond with rocks and different branches and big rocks, and maybe some twigs or dead wood that will create an environment that will be beneficial for all the natural predators. And this would be helpful to all the fruits that we want to protect naturally. And about cutting the grass, it's good there is Hélène Attau. I don't know if people know Hélène Attau, but she has the website Veganic Permaculture. And she discovered by doing research in agriculture that if we mow the lawn or we cut all the lawn underneath the trees, there is less space for natural predators and pollinators. So that's why it's better to have some, if we want to cut the grass, not to cut everything at once. And so just to have some places where animals can just lay and hide and make their nests in the ground, that would be also an important aspect. So not cutting all at once if we want to cut the lawn. And I think that's part of the ideas I would say for establishing a forest garden.
Thank you so much, Stephane. I know building a forest garden is an incredibly exciting and complex thing. We've been looking into that for our farm as well, how we can do that. And I'm so grateful for people like you and for this show, so we can ask these kind of questions. And I know if you go to the Vegan Organic Network's website, there's a farmer on there as well called Ian Tolhurst, and he does things like consultations. So you can even ask these amazing people who are on the show, I'm sure, and people who are much smarter than me. I definitely want your help to get this, because I would never think of those things in a million years. And I think when we all work together, we can create some real magic. And it's beautiful that we have this show. Piers, Meghan, anything you'd like to add about how they can build this amazing forest garden?
I just say to do it in steps. Sometimes, you know, I have a friend who did a huge forest garden in 1 year just because they had funding to do it all in 1 year. And then they got the worst drought ever for 2 years in a row, which was very tough on the forest garden. You might also find that you've got voles that come and eat the trees during the winter and things like that. So because it's something that can take a lot of work, it can also be kind of expensive to buy all of those trees. It's probably better to think about putting it in place over the course of 4 or 5 years, just do a patch, see if it works, learn from your mistakes, and then kind of move on, because it's going to be there for 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 years. So it's not a big deal if it takes a few years to do.
Fantastic. Thank you all so much. We're going to wrap up the show very shortly. Please give everyone who's listening, please give some amazing comments for Piers and Stephane and Meghan, and go check out their websites, and you can find them and learn more from them if you're interested. Definitely check out the Learn Veganic course and get in touch if you've been inspired. We really enjoy when we get these nice messages, and if anyone wants to send us more paintings, that's fantastic too. Thank you again to Maggie. And if you would like to support the Vegan Organic Network, please do go to the website. You can make a donation, or you can join our newsletter. So you can just sign up for a membership. We'll send you the newsletter, and there's so much fantastic knowledge in there. And we even have a festival coming up in Cornwall this year, so you can check out the Vegan Organic Festival, where you'll be able to come and meet us live and ask questions and connect. And we'll really look forward to seeing you there. Everybody, again, just thank you. Thank you for your time. Appreciate everything that you're doing. Keep making this big impact in the world. It really does create these huge ripples. And I've seen massive changes in the world in the last few years, especially. It seems like we're really getting a good foothold on this, and things are just going to keep getting more and more veganic, I'm sure. And thank you as well to Dan, who's been behind the scenes, pressing all the buttons, making everything work. And he's been a huge part of my journey with the Vegan Organic Network. So lots of love to you as well, Dan. And we hope you join us on the next episode of Veganic Gardeners Question Time. You can see all of our previous episodes on the Vegan Organic Network YouTube channel. So go check those out. There's so much beautiful wisdom there. And if you have any questions you'd like us to share in the next episodes, please do get in touch. Thank you so much, everybody, and good night.
Many thanks to our panel and to you for watching. Please support and join us on our veganic mission to be part of a worldwide movement for a peaceful, just world where agriculture is earth, animal, and human friendly.